Hey, I'd like to welcome everybody to the Lion's Den today. I'm Tony Douglas. I'm one of your hosts today. And I'd like to introduce Terrence Sams and also Terrence Jackson.
Hey!
What up? So these two make a dynamite. I'm just here. All right, listen.
Yeah.
Plug for my man.
Plug him.
Sonny D.
Sonny D!
Please. Oh, wow. Is
it please, give this man an endorsement for his shirt.
You got to say pause with that Sonny D, though.
Wait, pause. We ain't even introduced the guest yet. He cracking on my outfit.
Oh, my God.
Seriously?
So we was having a guest today. and Tutu Queen here.
Oh,
I got shorts on.
I got nuts.
And I ain't really going down like that, man.
Oh, I thought you had a squirt.
Oh. Come on, man. Get off my shirt. We ain't doing that. But anyway, today we glad to have everybody come sit with us in the Lion's Den. Another day of hot topics.
Hot topics,
so,
baby.
So, first of all, before we get this thing started, let Terrence go ahead, introduce yourself, tell everybody what you're about, and then you're going to lead us in prayer.
I love that, man. Yo, my name's Terrence Sams, and I'm here with Amplify Network. Before we go ahead and get everything kicked off, let's jump into prayer real quick.
Amen.
Father God, we just want to thank you for this day, Lord. I thank you for my brothers, God. Thank you for allowing us to be able to touch, motivate, and inspire someone today. Yes. So, Lord, just thank you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Then we have Terrence Jackson over here, comedian. If you keep it up, he won't be on the show too long. We're going to cut him off. Give me a tidbit, Terrence.
Everybody deserves grace, so we're going to give grace to my brother Tony in his Starburst shirt. And we're going to keep it pimping. I don't have nothing to say, man. Go ahead, man.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I think his leg is a little tight.
Yeah. I guess today, as I said, it's Toby Stevens. Am I correct?
Correct.
He's here from the Enhanced Training Champions.
Yes, correct.
Give us a little information about yourself.
Oh, man. Again, Toby Stevens from Enhanced Training Champions. Here in the DMV area for the last 20 years. I've been blessed to train some of the high professional level athletes in this area. And we continue to do that with much success, man, and with much prayer, man. So we hope to keep it going and keep these young men and young women, I guess, geared up for the next level.
Amen.
All right, let's get into our few for the week. I'm going to let Terrence start. Yeah. He got so many jokes. Get him out the way quick.
Captain Starburst, thank you so much. my few for the week, bros, and for, you know, anybody out there listening, I'm going to take something my brother Tommy Harris said to me. We was talking the other day, and this really blessed me. He said, T, it doesn't matter how much money a man has or how much esteem of what, you know, all the accolades he may have, money, anything. He said, you're only worth and only as valuable as the 24 hours God gives you. That's it.
Okay.
You're only worth the 24 hours that God gives you.
Yeah.
And what that means is, bruh, it doesn't matter how much money you got. If God takes you away right now, somebody else going to enjoy all that fortune.
All of it.
Can't take it with you.
You can't take it with you. Right. We all going to return back to the dirt.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So your value and your worth is only valued as much as the 24 hours God gives you. So that's my feel for the week, man.
I feel you. Right now, he's worth $19.95 in those legs.
Terrence, your feel for the week, bro. I'm just saying, I want to see him dance. I mean, I want the polo drop out. Because he's looking. No, but seriously, Terrence, give us your feel for the week. Leave skin tight alone.
Got him started.
What? He's cracking on my shirt, man. It was either the yellow shirt or the orange.
Oh, man.
When peanut M&M's and Starburst get together, it's real. It's good.
That's all right. I'll be the M&M. You be the peanut head.
Go ahead.
Now, listen. My fuel for the week is simple, man. Just whatever you do in life, be prepared for it. You know what I'm saying? Like it doesn't happen overnight. But what is for you will be for you, period. And no one can stop that from happening but you.
Amen.
You know what I'm saying? No one can stop that, pull you out of position but you by getting distracted by everything that you see. So whatever you're doing, stay locked in, stay focused, and be prepared. Be ready.
All right.
Good stuff, man.
So my few for the week, I actually had a great experience yesterday. My daughter, I had a chance to coach her in basketball.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I coached her out in McDonough High School. Mm-hmm. And so Coach Phil allowed me to sit with the team and actually coach the last yesterday and also a couple weeks ago. So it's really good getting a chance to really coach her from the sideline and say, hey, this is what you need to be doing. But also to help be instrumental with the other young ladies that I didn't know. But I had a chance to meet. Because every time we get together, it's a new series of girls. So it was like three or four new girls that came to the team yesterday, a couple different girls that we did. And really just giving them the time. You know, I like to give back. So for myself, it was really advantageous for me to just to do that, especially with my daughter. I'm going to give you the floor, Tope.
Oh, man. I mean, it sounds like everybody's giving their fuel of the week. If I can say my fuel of the week this week is to pretty much be present in the moment.
I like that.
And the reason why I say it is because we, you know, as individuals and everything we do in our walk of life, we're always thinking about, you know, either the future or thinking about the past. But, I mean, how about you be present in the moment that you have, you know what I'm saying, within that day that you have. And make that presence, you know what I'm saying, a presence where you can affect everybody around you. So I think being present in the moment and the cherishing that moment goes a long ways.
Yeah. I like that.
All right. Well, we got That Is coming up.
That Is.
Some hot topics coming off this press. First thing, you got Foles expected to sign an $88 million contract with the Jaguars. How y'all feel about that? $88 million. Foles. Nick Foles.
He worth that, man.
What?
He's worth that. How many years?
You on birth control, aren't you?
How many years?
I mean, come on, man. $88 million for Foles? He can't. Wait, when was the last time you saw Foles?
He just won Super Bowl MVP.
That was the year before.
That was last year.
It don't take three games to do that. So literally, I have a three-game run.
But you look at his track record. Before he left.
He left Philly. Yep.
He was a winner.
Did they win a Super Bowl?
No.
Okay, so he wasn't a winner.
They brought him back to win a Super Bowl.
See, anything for this brother past 8-8 is winning. I mean, that's winning. I get it.
Miami ain't won nothing lately. My Bills on visit to the playoffs.
Yeah, Dolphins fan? Not Tampa Bay.
Oh, well, that's Tampa Bay. Anything in Florida.
My papa Dolphins fan.
Yeah, Lakeland girl. Lakeland, Florida.
Oh, my God. I'm sorry.
Only the real come from Lakeland, baby.
Two people from Lakeland, Florida.
No, Terrence.
Terrence.
I can go down the list.
Terrence and Ray Lewis.
I can go down the list.
Ray helped compensate a whole lot.
Ray helped compensate a whole lot with that. You know what I mean?
No, but that, back to That Is. Sorry, Lakeland.
I mean, you got to say it right.
That Is, baby. So we what you feel about Foles getting that $88 million?
Listen, I think he deserves it.
I think so.
I mean, I here's the thing.
You
man.
From the other side of Florida?
No, I'm not from the other side of Florida. I mean, look, I'm gonna be honest with you, this is just my opinion. I think
your opinion don't count.
I'm about to bring Lewis in the Super Bowl. You know what I'm
saying? Hey, hold up, man.
Listen. I'm gonna tell you like this. When you suit it up,
right,
and you get ready, you go out here and you go to combat every day. I'm gonna tell you like this: you deserve it.
You risk your life every time you suit it up. So you think he worth $88 million?
Absolutely, I think he's worth it, man. I think any person that plays the game of football, especially at that high level, they're worth every dime they're willing to pay.
Oh, right, well, yeah, I agree to that. They're gonna give it to him. Yeah. Toby, you my last hope.
Hey brother, I gotta go against you, man. It ain't from Lakeland. Hey, listen, man. At the end of the day, I mean, any athlete, I mean, that's all you do. And at the end of the day, I mean, that's a sport that, you know, it come from concussions to CTE to being away from your family. It's a lot of things going on. Any piece of money that you can get at that large amount, hey, go get it.
You gotta think about it, man. Go get it. Listen, when he's done playing. This window real small. Yeah, it's real small, man. That's not always true for them. No. This is the point I'm gonna make. The point is the window's small. If you're lucky to play 8 to 10 years in the National Football League, that's big time.
Right.
The average person when they're done playing, they're barely 30 years old.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's a long career. 30 years, oh man, you still got a long life to live.
That money,
man. Here's the other part that's really bad, and I know we got to move on, but
because I got a lot of that
they don't pay you health care in the league. You have to pay for that yourself.
You don't need health care. I just gave you $88 million.
You're tripping.
I just gave you $88 million.
I need all of it.
Okay. Next subject on That Is. You got AB. He got traded to the Raiders. Mm-hmm. For a third and a fifth round draft choice? Are you kidding me? AB, top five receiver. Yeah. Number one in receiving yards over the last 4 or 5 years.
Didn't they give him 50 mil?
I don't care what they gave him. I'm only getting a third and a fifth. And also, the Steelers eating $21.1 million.
The Steelers only getting a third and a fifth round?
They get a third and a fifth. That's and they're eating $21.1 million off the salary cap.
I thought they were getting two first rounds.
No, sir. Third and a fifth.
I think that was just a bad decision on the GM. That's a bad. I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, you got AB. I mean, they say that it was between him and Ben. So he's going to come out balling. I mean, you got to get more than that. You got to get more than that for AB. I mean, one of the top receivers in the game.
And
I mean,
sure I mean, somebody might say the top I'm positive, man. I'm the host.
I thought they had the host with the host.
You got to get more than that from AB.
You got to. And I'm sure my Buffalo Bills offered more than that. How you not going to come to Buffalo?
He would have committed.
Because I know you watched.
Football suicide had he went to the Bills. Yeah, he was smart. That was a dungeon.
Wait a minute.
You to the Bills. He said, heck no. I'd be dang if I go to the Bills.
See, I was really feeling our connection.
I am about to commit football suicide. No.
Almost like
that's the witness protection plan for the NFL, boy. The Bills are.
Take a look. Okay, all my Bills. All my Bills. Y'all get too happy. We about to have some problems.
Oh, my God.
You know, the set ain't going to look the same.
Oh, my God. Now, I go to the Bills.
I think that was a good
quit
move.
Football first.
Good move for who? I think it was a good move.
Terrence, you watch football.
Stop. Listen. That was a good move for AB. Because if he looking at everyone on the table, going to the Raiders, he has a nice quarterback.
He's in a big market.
Big market.
About to get a
nice
new
quarterback. New field,
new stadium, new everything.
I think that was a good move.
They'll be in Las Vegas.
Vegas.
Right.
But the question is, was that the only deal? That's the question.
It was because Pittsburgh probably wanted to get rid of him because of all the stuff that was going on. Right? But was that the only deal on the table? And that's the key. So if you eat $21.2 million or $21.1 million out of a $22 million cap, that means you was trying to get rid of somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
That means this person was causing division so bad.
Cancer.
Yeah,
had to be.
It was cancer. It's almost like him taking off these leggings. It's going to be some cancer on them legs.
Because when have you known Pittsburgh to, I mean, they're paying him to go.
Hey, man.
Right.
Said they're paying him to go.
They're paying to get rid of him.
That just shows you that you're not bigger than the program.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what it is.
I ain't like you anyway, AB, so nah. I'm feeling some kind of way.
AB's nice, man.
He is.
I mean, a talent-wise, he has a nice
You can't
talent.
Just disrespect the city of Buffalo and think you just going to go, we ain't going to talk about this. It's almost like...
Who is the... What's the cat from Florida that did the same thing? Willis McGahee? Y'all remember that?
Willis McGahee came to Buffalo, and when they traded him, he banned him off the city after he ran around the city having fun with multiple women. And he said, what, nothing to do with bowling? You're laughing too hard, guest. Too much laughter. Come back down. We ain't even at your segment yet.
Oh man.
Okay, back to here's another piece of that ish. We got Jameson Crowder. He just got signed by the New York Jets for I think $24.7 million. Okay. How y'all feel about that?
And he from NC. As long as he's from North Carolina, we good to go, baby.
same pretense, man. If you're able, you blessed enough to get that money.
Yeah, you blessed enough to get the money. I'm not tripping. I'm not hating. Go get the money. Yeah. If they're going to pay you, why am I going to say you're not worth it? Obviously, they feel like you're worth it.
And plus, most of the players getting pimped anyway. So
yeah.
Get your money.
I mean, that's just like, I'm going to be honest with you, T. At the end of the day, that's just like if the Syracuse Orangemen came and offered you $2.5 million to be their mascot right now. I'm not going to hang on that.
I want you to be in Buffalo.
He's in New York, though. See, most people from North Carolina don't know that, though.
No, it's close to Niagara Falls.
You've been around. You know what I'm saying?
It's close to Niagara Falls. You know what I'm saying? And by the way, I trained Frank Howard.
Yeah, you're
that's where that training came in. So they educated you. I got it.
I mean, I lived in South Carolina for a while.
Most people
I would say, hey, I'm from Buffalo, New York. Oh, you know Tupac?
No. But I use it to my advantage, though.
Sister want to say, hey, you know, Tupac, man, we hang out, we do this. What?
Come on. I know you could do that, but I'm just saying.
But anyway, here's the last ish. That ish. That ish. We got Landon Collins. Just signed for a whopping 84 million. Well, he's expected to sign.
Right.
For 84 million with your dead skins. Oh, I said that wrong.
I'm not a skin fan.
See, you're a jumper.
Chicago. Chicago.
I'm Chicago Bears fan. I've been that my whole life. Bro.
Chicago Bears?
Yeah, absolutely. Bears fan. Walter Payton.
Yeah,
Richard Dent.
Yeah,
you know, Mike Singletary. You know what I'm saying?
Really? Who are dead skins?
No, I'm a Cowboys fan. Nah, you know.
Oh, I forgot.
You're a Lakers.
Yeah, I'm a Lakers.
Tampa Bay Bucks, baby.
Aren't they going to lose their team? I heard they thinking about trading the team away.
Oh, really?
No.
But I just want to see his face look all concerned and scared.
Listen, okay, so we're going to get right into the 10-minute ticker. The 10-minute ticker is this. I got some good ones for y'all. We want to give a shout-out to the International Women's Day.
Mm-hmm.
You heard about what Steph Curry did. I'm assuming everybody on board with this.
Mm-hmm.
Steph Curry put out a new sneaker that's exclusively designed for women, which no other male NBA player has ever done.
Right.
He let a young lady that was 9 years old help design a sneaker because she wrote him a letter saying, hey, Steph, I'm your number one fan, and I can't even go buy you a Curry 5s that's about to come out.
Wow.
So Curry heard that, thought about, hey, I got two daughters. He reached out to the young lady to help him design the sneaker. Now, what I'm asking you is, do you think that was just a marketing ploy, or do you think it was sincerity?
I think it was sincerity.
Yeah,
I
his
think
part, yeah.
He, his part, he's one of the most authentic individuals that I've ever seen. You know, his his heart condition is really good.
Mm-hmm.
The only decision that I thought that he made that was poor is that he's with Under Armour. But outside of that,
really, that's great. How you feel?
That's exactly how I feel.
But I think Steph is a hell of a guy.
Yeah, I
really do.
No, I totally agree with you. I think on his part, that was totally from the heart.
Mm-hmm.
But business standpoint, they looked at it and said, yo, this is a win-win situation. Yeah. Everybody's going to win, and it's going to make Under Armour look better.
Right.
Yeah. but to help you out, brother, I mean, it was, again, I think that it was sincere from his heart, too, and what he's doing. But at the end of the day, Nike will say, we'll take that, we'll get a female, and we'll do Nike shit.
They're the first to do it.
But that's what I mean. Sometimes you gotta go out on a limb, as opposed to signing with Nike, who didn't remember his name, gave him they put up a PowerPoint with somebody else's name on it.
Sure.
You know what I mean? So I'm going to a place where they want me, first of all. I'm helping to build a brand. Because
right.
like when I go into the gym now, if you go into a lot of training facilities where there's young kids, they got on them Under Armour. Because 2 years ago, everybody was Steph Curry crazy.
Well, let's say this. That's great and all. Let's make sure that Steph Curry is smart enough to have stock into Under Armour and have a lot of it.
That was some of the
ownership. If he's helping build that brand, let's hope that his people around him have
big ownership. Big pimping.
They gonna pimp. Hey, you pimp too.
Absolutely. I think it was fantastic on his part.
Yeah.
You know, I really do, and it was a great move, man.
Yeah, I mean, because think about this. I got a daughter that plays basketball. She's 5'10". She's a guard. And when I take her to get sneakers, I never thought about it. We in a boys department. Though she do wear 11 and a half in boys. Hey, man, that's my daughter.
Hey, everybody was like,
but see, I said, wait, I just felt that.
Yeah,
just
wait, wait, no, like,
no. I had addressed that, and then you just added to it.
I mean, her foot bigger than yours.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm so looking at your foot.
Yeah, here's the funny part.
These 11s. Here's the funny part.
She had the LeBron, the black joints. I had the gray joints. So she only wears sneakers when she get in the gym. And so every couple months, we get a new pair. How much you really wearing them out, right?
Right, yeah.
So I sat the other day, man. I'm sitting there helping her. I'm domesticated now, remember, because I'm waiting for my food truck. So I'm in her room cleaning up her room, and I see these brand new, that's about 8 pair of sneakers in the closet. Mm. So I said, I'll take these,
right,
and I'll take these.
Right.
So they went back with me to my room. Yeah. I think I might have last week on a show wore the black
Right. It burns me.
So you snatch
them. I stopped giving them to the little boy Ben across the street. Right. He's older than her.
Yeah. Okay.
And said, you know what? I don't keep this in the house.
Hey. Right.
Sometimes you got to keep the proceeds in the house.
You do. You do with that.
So here's my second part of the 10-minute ticker. Who's really benefiting from the NCAA in terms of athletics? Is it the athlete or is it the institution? And if it's not the athlete, should they be compensated?
What do you think?
Go ahead, Tom.
Oh, it's most definitely the institution. And yes, the athlete should be compensated.
Why is it? Like, what is fair compensation?
That's the point. Well, I have a theory on it that it's the same way with rankings. They have 3-star, 4-star, 5-star kids. I know your daughter is probably going to be, you know, amongst some of those rankings when it gets to the college programs. But it's the same way. Every scholarship is what? 1 year. It's only one institution that does 4-year scholarships, and that's Notre Dame. That's the only. That's the only
institution. Guarantee.
So at the end of the day, it's like the workforce. If I come in as a freshman, and you know, you say I come in as a freshman and I'm a 5-star recruit, I get 5-star money. Now, let's say going to my sophomore year, you're going to sit down and evaluate me, because that's what I'm doing, I'm working. You're going to evaluate me from my freshman year, then the next class comes in. If that kid that comes in as a 3-star recruit,
mm-hmm.
or either, you know what I'm saying, a 4-star recruit, once I get into my junior year and they go through their freshman year and they evaluate and that kid came in and performing better than me, they have to flip that money. Like, it's now the 3-star recruit came in, did better than my 5-star recruit after the 1 year service. So now we have to switch monies. If that 5-star recruit doesn't accept that, they have a transporter pole anyway for college athletes where you can transfer if you want to. So it's like the workforce.
But I think I think that's where it's going to get muddy, because we're talking about
money. Yeah, I think it'll get complicated.
We're talking about transferring money to a 5-star compared to a 3-star. It's going to cause a lot of division, especially.
Why would it?
Think about it this way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a 5-star, and we know Terrence only a 2-star. So he come in, right, and say, I'm having, me and my coach, I got a new coach, but I decided to stay.
Okay.
But this is his recruit.
Okay.
So now he's getting more playing time than me, and so I'm really not shining. But I'm knowing I'm better than him.
What happens on the workforce when someone comes in and get hired new that maybe that boss didn't hire you and they hire somebody else?
They have to do that
too. Well, that's when you with a good company. They bring you in stages, meaning you can't come in and make it no more than this.
Okay.
So generally, when people come in, when we talk about just typically a workforce,
mm-hmm.
they're going to be working less than somebody, getting paid less than somebody that's already been there.
Well, that's due to whatever mm-hmm. stipulations that
you that have. That organization.
Yeah, right. I mean, you have to set out, which NCAA doesn't do, you have to have rules and regulations.
Right.
I mean,
so that's what I'm saying. We would have to implement a lot of rules and regulations.
Yeah, here's my thing. Football, we all know football brings the most money in any university.
Absolutely. Period. SEC, big business.
You know, right. it's just what it is. My opinion is this. You come in, the worst thing in the world is to play in front of 90,000. After the game, you sign in autographs, taking pictures, and then go to your dorm room and you have nothing to eat in your refrigerator. That's
right,
terrible.
Right.
And even if the coach was to say, man, let me buy you some tacos. You feel me? You're now in violation.
Right.
Which is crazy, but I'm hungry. I need something to eat. I look at it like this. Just like they give you a per diem, they just need to up the per diems and make it worth it, in my opinion. So, look, if it's like, at this point, each football player is getting $4,000 a month.
I don't believe.
It needs to be something sustainable, man.
I don't believe there's any player in the SEC that finish a game that's not eating. Now, if we was at maybe HBCU.
Think about this. Tony, hold up. Think about this. You're a big offensive lineman, man. You getting your 3 meals a day.
Right, right.
That's mandated. Okay, right. You understand what I'm saying? But, T, you may not have the availability. These cats is going to be hungry more than three times in a day. So they may not have nothing too tangible really to go and
come
eat.
Come on, ramen noodles go a long way. Everybody know about ramen noodles.
But you got to look at the schedule that they're on. That is crazy, man.
You talking about ramen noodles, but right. you making steak money. Like,
right.
I'm beating my body up. So they eat ramen noodles.
Right.
Which goes back to the point. Make the per diem a week more. Listen, if it equated to,
Because let's just be honest here. There's kids that are playing football in college. They got kids.
And listen,
they have family. Right. So married. Right.
And not only that, when you get recruited to, let's say, your Alabamas and your Clemsons and Penn States, where do they usually take these kids? They take them to the coach's house, which is making all the money.
Mm-hmm. So Nick Saban making $11 million a year.
I don't understand. That's another subject.
So, go ahead.
No, I'm saying the only way to do that is to make it equal across the board.
That's what I'm saying.
You can't make it.
No, I'm just saying you don't have to make it where if you're a 3 or 4 star, whatever. I'm just saying if you make it where the per diem a month is sustainable, man. Listen, those kids can live off of $3,000 or $4,000 a month, man. You know what
now
I'm saying?
Now that's 40,000. So now you're saying that kid going to be getting paid $47,000.
Think about this.
A year.
But here's the deal. When you go to a football game, I'm talking about one game, it's $9 for a dang soda and $7 or $8 for a hot dog.
No. Okay, so I'm going to say this. If we're going to
get to a bowl game. That school's making $11 million.
So think of you get a book bag with a bunch of gifts.
That's it. You got a new PlayStation. Here we go. You got a new system. They giving away home theater systems, and you don't have a TV. Get out of here, man.
Well, here we go. If we gonna compensate them in terms of giving them money, then it got to be stipulation said like a job. That your grade point average got to be on point.
You got to earn the appropriate grade. Again, I just think when it comes to the NCAA, it's been no rules.
No rules.
I'm saying adding that rules.
They're one of the few monopolies in this country.
We will never get to anything in agreement until rules are being placed amongst the NCAA, and there's never been any rules.
Right.
So again, they play by their own rules. They make rules as they go.
Right.
So again, if we got Congress into this to make rules and stipulations on how these players are getting paid, that's what needs to happen first. It needs to be a committee to see how this structure needs. And you can get the your big time CEOs and businesses and different things like that on this board to see how these individuals can get paid, because again, they're considered indentured servants. They are providing a service to a school, and that school is getting paid, and I'm not making
millions of dollars.
Like Toby said,
think about this. And I don't mean to cut you off, T. Last year, the year before last, they had a deal that came out. The University of Alabama's football program made that school, just the football team itself, over $108 million.
Oh, let me add something to that to you, Terrence.
Just the football team.
Hold on. Let me add something to that to you. The strength coach at Alabama makes over $400,000 a year.
What? Just a strength coach, bro.
So again, let's
he ain't calling no play.
It ain't living no way. No way. So let's look at the structure, and again, that's why the NBA is going to a whole nother level, because these guys that are actually playing the sport and they're taking over the sport, and they can complain about it as much as they want, but at the end of the day, the player should be making the money and should be setting the rules. But again, it should be rules in place, and football should be the same, not the good old boy system.
And I know we got to move on because we on time, but think about this. Football is, when you look at, I'll say this, Adrian Peterson was probably one of the few players I can honestly say could have went to the National Football League out of high school, man. It's mandated you got to play three years
right.
in college or...
Two years. It's your age.
Three years or your age. You know what I'm saying? Right. That allows
you
to go.
I think that's right. And they're playing against grown men.
I understand that. I'm not knocking that. But what I'm telling you is that I still got to go and slave for 3 years, regardless whether or not,
even if I'm no guarantee.
They're not even some of your top more upper echelon athletes that have an opportunity to be a lottery pick. If you don't have somebody that's willing to insure your body, you gotta find a way.
People doing it.
Yeah, so but athletes, you get the Lords of London. But where are you getting that from?
But again, you have to be a top tier athlete for you to even get that.
Right, that is true.
I'm saying the NCAA should insure some of these kids, their bodies at least, man. If you're out there playing, at least let's make it worth their while. Isn't that where education comes in?
Because they're giving them a free
ride. Get out of here, man. Ain't no free ride. It's year to year anyway.
I'm just going to be Terrence right now. I'm being devil advocate. I'm giving you a platform to play on. I'm giving you a free education. I'm giving you room and board. I'm giving you a meal plan.
No.
Why not? I'm get, that's no, what I'm no, giving you.
No, and I'm giving myself, I'm giving you my likeness, and you're selling my jersey at the game for $100+. I walk down the street, yeah. I look in the store, I see my jersey hanging up, but I got $5 in my pocket. Get out of here. Okay, I gave you a platform too.
Well here it is.
That's how okay. I feel.
Okay, here it is. So we're going to agree to disagree. So in reality, if there was no institutions offering you that, what would you be doing with your skills?
They'll figure something else out.
What would you be doing?
Something else would be jumping off. Something else would be popping. How about that? You hear me?
That's that ish. That's
true. Something else would be popping.
Say, put some respect on my name.
Before we get into our full court press, I want to make a statement. We mentioned earlier, and I think it was Brother Toby said, there was one institution that offered a four-year ride. Mm-hmm. Actually, I thought about it. There's several.
Okay.
You have Army, Navy, and the Air Force. they right, offer we, you right, a full right,
I got
ride.
You, I got you. I got
but
you.
On the back end, you have to do military service.
Right, right.
So I just wanted to add that because, you know, our audience might be watching say, no.
That's right. You're right. You're right. Right, right. But they can have that.
I'm Navy. Yeah, they can have that. Well,
I respect everything they do, but just know how that's just not for me.
I
respect it. It's a job. I respect it so much.
Oh, yeah. Terrence, you was in the Navy. You went through Brownies, Girl Scouts, and the Navy.
My man.
Nobody safe on this show. Everybody get a chance to get cracked on.
Let's get into this full court press. We got, as we said earlier, we got Toby Stevenson. I mean Steven. Here, and he's from the Enhanced Training Championship.
Correct.
Champions.
Correct.
Give us a little synopsis or a little understanding of your program. And today's topic, we're going to talk about how athletes may come to you. And then they'll make it to the league, be it the NFL, the NBA. And then they get an agent, and the agent actually talks them into finding another trainer. So I know that's a sensitive issue with you, but we want to give you your platform.
I got you. Well, again, like I stated before, I've been blessed in the DMV area for the last 20 years to pretty much train some of the best athletes in this area.
Throw out some of your clients.
Yeah, Navarro Bowman, Rodney McLeod, Super Bowl champion. Trey Sullivan, Super Bowl champion. Torrey Smith, Super Bowl champion. My first client here in the DMV was Cato June, another Super Bowl champion. Mm. Going from basketball to Quinn Cook, NBA champion. Vic Depot, Jaren Grant, Jeremy Grant, Dennis Schroeder. That was a great experience. This summer, I spent 6 weeks in Germany. Dennis flew me over, spent six weeks in Germany, and trained him for his training. From the Atlanta Hawks to the Oklahoma Thunder. So that was a great experience in itself. But I can go on and go on. I mean, with numerous AAU teams. I'm also blessed by being the strength and conditioning coach with DeMatha High School, one of the top high schools, not only in this area, but in the country. So again, you know, when it comes to these young men, I'm always around some of the best athletes in the country. And by saying that, it was a topic in the beginning of starting training that, you know, I never really looked at it in the beginning because my thing was just trying to help kids. Mm-hmm. And the thing was within
it was a passion.
Well, yeah, in the African American community, you know, we've always been taught to go to school, get education. And my thing was, okay, how about, you know, these kids helping these kids get a free education, right, which we just talked about. Right. But as you continue to go through the layers of the institutions and everything that's happening behind the scenes, you kind of say, hey, like, something is wrong here. And, you know, it always stands a point in my mind, DeMarcus Nelson, who played for Duke. Mm-hmm. I went out to Sacramento and trained his younger brother, Darius Nelson, and they're on the West Coast, and I went out there and I'm training him, and his dad always told me, you know, he was like, well, Toby said, you got all these guys and you train all these people. He said, you know, why do you train them and then you let somebody else take them to the next level or profit off of it? And I was like, well, you know, what you mean?
Yeah, once they get there, get to the league, leave.
Yeah, and at first I didn't understand what he was saying because I'm saying, you know, again, I'm going back into the passion part of the job. But then I thought about it like, at the end of the day, you know, as you continue to grow, you see other institutions getting bigger and bigger and bigger, mm-hmm. and you see yours not even growing, but you've trained.
Right. So you just wanted to get the opportunity to keep training these guys. Right. Yeah, have got to elite platform.
Right. Yeah. My goal going in was, number one, to help individuals. Number two, it was to train professional athletes. Right. That was the goal in the beginning. But again, it started to be a point where once you're educating these young men and getting mm-hmm. them to a certain point, then they're not educating on the business process. So after the 20 years, it's now going from the training, now I've pretty much been into a situation where I'm learning the business side of it. So the business side of it is where the athlete don't even see that side of it, or maybe not even concerned about that part of it. But that's the side of it that is very important, not only to just small trainers, but it's important to African-American communities.
Right. So would you say, what percentage of your athletes are minorities? African American specifically?
Oh, probably 99%. Yeah, I would say 98%.
Now that 98%, generally what we tend to do is go find a white agent. 75% of us.
Well, let me tell you how that process works. Mm-hmm. And again, that's what we're trying to do is get people to understand the process. I think that when you see the process, you can understand what goes on. So what we talked about earlier, a lot of those young men, it's kind of like life insurance. A lot of those young men are already pre-certified to make money.
Right.
And if you don't know what I mean by that is, mm-hmm. if you have a five-star kid,
right,
it's projected.
Five-star, two-star. Five-star.
Right. So.
Right.
It's bus.
Well, at least. I got that money in the beginning. What are we talking about? Get the money in the front.
Yeah, I mean, I got the money.
Listen, this is very important. This is why I want you to see the process of it, and that we think like that. Again, if you have a five-star athlete, that five-star athlete is projected, if it's in football or basketball, mm-hmm. to go to the next level, which right. is NFL, NBA, etc. Yeah. Okay. So from your agent side of it, the draft, those kids are already projected to go in the draft. So as an agent, and now that agents now have to get less percentage of the money, of the earnings, mm-hmm. they started that last year. Now what an agent already does is it's already a list of kids that they already know the teams want. Mm-hmm. So as an agent, if I'm putting money into an individual kid, guess what I'm going to do?
I'm sending them where I want to send
them. Well, no. First I'm going to do is I'm going after the kids I know are already going to get drafted.
Absolutely.
So that's why HBCUs and those smaller schools, they don't have agents to pay for their training. Because as a businessman, mm-hmm. why would I make an investment into something that I'm not going to make any money off of? So what it does is psychologically, you have kids thinking, hey, this guy just gave me money. Mm-hmm. No, he didn't. What that guy did was mm-hmm. he did his homework on you. And knew that you was going to be a projected draft pick. He knew he was going to get his money back.
So why would they actually take a kid from their trainer and say, yo, I want you to work with this guy, if this particular trainer gotten them to the point where they are?
Well, it's a business.
Well, right. It comes with business. It's like anything that you do with business. When you get to certain levels, and that's where, again, now it sets a presence to me of what Mr. Nelson said is, why don't you go all the way with the kid mm-hmm, instead of giving right. the kid to somebody else? Because in business, and you know, I hate to say this, but with us African Americans, mm-hmm. sometimes we don't support, sometimes we don't invest in, mm-hmm. and that's what happens. Right. So if I'm a kid, and you know, I you know subconsciously think that other you know races or other individuals are very smarter and they can get me where I need to go, that's where they're going to tend to go. Not only that, those individuals are going to mm-hmm. send those kids to their business colleagues.
but see that goes back to, if you want to change a culture, like I said last week, it's about pouring into your seed.
Yeah, right.
And that's us teaching and pouring into our yep. kids the value of certain things, because at the end of the day, the player needs to know I have the power. Mm-hmm. I it's my choice truly, and whether this agent says, hey, I want you to go here to Arizona and trim this guy or this person, you know what? Me personally, I'm gonna say, well, you know what? At the end of the day, mm-hmm. I'm really paying for this.
Because right. Let's say this. Let's take.
It's gonna cost me.
Let's take this. Let's say you have a five star athlete, okay? And let's say that five star athlete, because you do know with the pre-testing, they do junior combine training, So what I mean by that is every university has a junior day. So the league offices, the scouts, they already know what these guys are already running. Okay. So let's say they go into their senior year. Okay. So let's say last year that kid ran a 4.4. Okay. Kid plays. Now it's time for the draft. All right. Your agent sends you out to, and the majority of places are Florida, California, Texas, those areas. And that's what's so, you know, intriguing about this area. You have a lot of kids that come out of this DMV area, and they don't even have facilities to train out of. You know what I'm saying? But let's go back to that. So how long do you think, if you already run a 4.4, you go through your football season, combine comes up, how much faster do you think you're going to get?
Not even a tenth of a second.
Okay, so all training programs are 8 weeks. So you go and you pay this trainer that only have known you for small, because what they do is they have the list of kids that are getting drafted also. So these big time companies, they go after the same kids. So some of those agent friends are sending them, hey, this guy's going to get drafted here. This guy's going to get drafted. So as a trainer, I'm like, oh, well, I'm going to make sure I go after this kid here. So they're doing their due diligence throughout the year, saying come to our facilities, come train with us. But again, in 8 weeks, if you don't run track and you're a football player, I'm only going to be changing so much. If you run a 4.4, why am I changing anything that you as far as technique-wise? So what I'm getting at is some of these companies are making over $500,000 in 8 weeks. Huh? Yeah.
Yeah, it's easy business, man.
Easy. Because, again, the system is the system is played out.
You're in the wrong business.
I'm in the wrong business.
Oh, okay. The system, and that's, again, that's why, you know, certain people are elbowed out, you know, and making sure that this money doesn't so much circulate so far. We want to make sure that we're making this money. But, again, those kids are already running those fast times. And a lot of those kids, you know, especially college kids, you go back and you train with whoever you train with. You might have trained with that trainer in high school. You might have, I mean, I've had kids that we've started training 8 years old. Now, if that kid is projected to be a number one, or let's say first rounder, second round, third rounder, your agent is really riding your ticket. So especially if you're a first runner. Right. So as a kid, again, we talked about empowering the family. You can say, hey, I don't feel comfortable going there. I want to go to my old trainer.
Right.
So whatever that agent is paying from that $20,000.
So, is going to come back on the kid anyway.
So here's my thing. So if that's the case, in the case of your situation, why isn't that manifesting? What is it that the kids are missing?
It's the family, or that the parents are missing. It's not being educated on the business. It's like anything you do. If I can, it's just like we talked about earlier, the NCAA. If I can hold what I'm doing on my left side and my right side don't know, then I'm gonna make sure that I'm holding all the money.
Well, but then think about it this way: if you had a kid from the age of 8 or 7 or 9, and they get to that position, and they don't stop to say, listen, I had Toby for this long, then some of that Toby is kind of you planting that seed, or you lack thereof.
It's it's parent too, man.
Well, not only parent, you got to understand that
I'm loyal. Loyalty is big.
Let's talk about the era we in, talking about loyalty. Like, I get on kids about, you know, about after a certain amount of time, what kids do with their Instagrams, they're a race.
Right.
And I always tell kids, I said, if you go back on any of my Instagram or IG situations, it'll go back to when I started. Because what I like to do is I like to see people see the process, see the growth. And that the same way they do that with Instagram is the same way they do with their memory. They're erasing. Once kids get to certain levels, they'll erase everything.
No. It goes with your book, The Recipe. See, you remember that subject? Somebody said, listen, if you're erasing your emails and you're erasing stuff, you got something to hide. We ain't got nothing to hide. The young generation, they running from this place to that place to doing this to doing that. So that's one of the reasons why they erasing.
Could be.
You know what I mean?
Could be.
Think about it.
I mean, it's, once again, it all starts at the house.
I believe that.
Good principle, godly principle. And
it should start at the house.
It should. Right is right, wrong is wrong. And listen, man, no matter what the case or situation is, for me personally, if I know that this man has helped me along the way, and you can tell this too, because some cats, they'll go on that adventure, but my daddy always say, bread will bring you back home, boy.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm saying, man? Hey, they realize I gotta go back to what really fits, what works, man.
But some of it goes hand in hand. Well, Toby was saying, you got an agent that's filling your mind saying, I'm one of the top agents. I'm exclusive to my clients. Mm-hmm. But with this goes, I got Terrence Sams here, who's a top tier trainer. Mm-hmm. So they buying into the package.
Right. Yep. And I get that, but it does come with a lot of education and educating the family. Mm-hmm. So it's almost as if when you grab a kid at a young age, that's when you start really almost like courting the family.
So for us, and Toby does this, you know, with his company, he started having symposiums where he's educating the parents. What our Life Skills Football Camp, which Toby is one of the trainers that runs the football camp, mm-hmm. You know, it's the life skills part. We're pouring into them because a lot of the parents are completely
if you don't know, you don't know.
So some of them, the kids, we're never going to get. You know why? Because we as a culture or society don't believe in each other.
Right. That's correct.
And so you can tell a kid, hey, listen, do this, do that, do this. But in reality, I can see a brand new pair of Nike sneakers that Terrence bought, and he's selling them. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask him, where you get them from? Mm-hmm. But I can go up to the Arab store or Arabian store and not ask any questions. Right. And knowing they fake.
Right. Yeah.
But I'm going to question him where he got them.
And that's true. And I think it's also hard to combat someone who said, look, my trainer trained LeBron James. You're immediately thinking, oh, I can be to that tier if I go with this particular trainer. So, they have a lot of influence and backing behind them. But I really think, like you were saying, man, once you start teaching the family what to look for, mm-hmm. which way to go, mm-hmm. how to shift it, I think it'll be okay.
But that's a big bridge to cross.
You have to start somewhere.
It's funny that you say it because my mission from here on out is that's what I said to myself. I said, if I never in my generation get to see it, mm-hmm. at least I'm going to be the one to start it.
Absolutely.
At least I'm going to be the one to start holding conversations about it. Right. Let's start holding people accountable. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So again, so these young men, these families can understand that this is the system. This is the system, going back to what you were saying earlier, this is the system that needs to be broken in our culture, mm-hmm. needs to be going into a different direction because, again, like we talked about earlier off the air, one NFL, one NBA player, one Major League Baseball player can change the direction of everything. Many families because you can create many of jobs. So let's go back. When you can create many of jobs, what is that making you? A CEO. Mm-hmm. So is that in these athletes' mind knowing that, hey, you're not just an athlete. Right. And that's why I have to commend LeBron James
right.
and some of these individuals that are coming out saying we're more than athletes. Yo, you are businessmen. But again, you weren't taught those business skills. So again, that's where going to the symposiums, going to the parents, getting them to understand how the business works, and hopefully, you know, down the line we can get this, you know, fixed, right. and also get these young men to understand, and also young women to understand that they hold the power and they can change, you know, saying directions of how sports are going.
Glad he said young women, because I tell my daughter all the time, if you get the opportunity and you get a chance to go on a D1 ride to play basketball, first look at the institution, and just because it's white don't mean it's right.
Right. Right. Right.
Reach out for HBCU. Mm-hmm. Bring that money back into our community, mm-hmm. the HBCUs, to try to bring them up. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And while I'm on that subject, I want to give a shout-out to my boy Fred Bachelor, who just got the MEAC Coach of the Year Women's Basketball.
Oh, congratulations.
So, congratulations, nice. Congratulations, Fred Bachelor. My man, Buffalo, homegrown.
That's going to be another conversation in regards to HBCUs and athletes, big-time athletes going to HBCUs and why they don't.
Mm-hmm. I thought someone was going to jump last year after Cam Newton's little brother did it. I thought it was going to be more.
Yeah, right, right.
You know what I mean? So I really would like to see that. But I don't know if
Cam Newton's brother, was he a three or four star?
He was top 100. He started. He was top 100. Pretty good. I don't know if he made the league.
He was top 100. He's a junior.
He's still going to another year at Howard University. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, if he got into Howard outside of just being an athlete, their requirements are pretty high to get in. So, you know, he's probably a good student too. So,
and think about it. If he don't make it, he can always become a manager.
Hey.
A water boy.
Hey. But listen, that's Cam creating another job. That's
right. I mean, that's... And, you know, there was probably a whole bunch of major D1 schools probably offering that scholarship just because of that, too. Who his brother is, you know, sometimes that carries weight.
Yeah. Hey, name recognition. My dad said if you ain't got good credit, you ain't got a good name.
Yeah.
So,
I'll take it. I'll take it every time.
Right now.
That's true, man.
So, I want to thank my brother here, Toby, for coming out with us.
Thank you guys for having that topic today.
Thank you guys for having me. I want to thank everybody on our discussion group. Yeah. Terrence. and once again, I want to definitely thank the ladies who are important in our life. And last week, the International Day for Women.
Backbone.
We're going to discuss that on another day. Yeah. So once again, we thank our audience for signing in with us. And remember, the views of this panel does not
affect
or speak for the Amplify Network. So once again, Toby, we're gonna let you lead us out in prayer today.
Oh man,
you better pray right.
Hey, we talk about this on air.
We didn't write that contract.
We didn't write that
contract. That ain't in my contract.
But no. Okay. Lord, I just like to say thank you for just continuing to bless, Lord. Thank you for just having these young men here to address topics, Lord, that we as a community, Lord, and we as a nation, Lord, and we as human beings, Lord, need to address. And Lord, we just thank you for all that you do for us, Lord. And Lord, we ask you to continue to just be with us, Lord. Continue to just heal us from our head to crown of our heads to the sole of our feet, Lord. And we give all praises to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hey, Toby, before we go, how can they get in contact with you, man, if they wanted to reach out to you?
Our social media is at ET Champions. Mm-hmm. So that's our IG. So again, it's at ET Champions. Our website is www.etchampions.com. So our website again is www.etchampions.com. You know, for your old heads, we're on Facebook. You can either go to Enhanced Training Champions or you can go to my name, Toby Stevens, which is T-O-B-E. Last name, Stevens with a P-H.
Love it.
All right. Yeah. All right. Well, Toby, E.T., go home. You are now out the Lions Den.
You're out of the Lions Den.
Thanks again, fellas. All right,
man. Much love, man.
Much love, man. That's what's up.
Oh, my goodness.
A woman dunking? Crazy. Coaching an NBA team? Crazy. A woman competing in a hit job? Changing her sport? Landing a double cork 1080? Or winning 23 Grand Slams, having a baby, and then coming back for more? Crazy, 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 and crazy. So if they want to call you crazy, fine. Show them what crazy can do.